And we're back with the stream number 14, part 2. So we need to try and wrap this guy up. I'm going to work on a beak a little bit more right now. So let's just, okay. Let's just quickly select beak and both maxilla and mandible, and let's start. So I know what happened. What I did is I forgot the very thing that I warned you guys against before. I have a HD geometry details on this head, and I sort of copied it to another set of subtools, and my HD geometry went away, so I need to go back to the original file and attach the forelimb, the leg, and the rest of the subtools to this set of subtools, the original, with the head, and this is the way we'll keep the HD geometry intact. So let me just select other pieces and just quickly append them to our head. I'm not sure why this doesn't work, why ZBrush, like Pixelogic, why they chose to, disable, copying and duplicating subtools that are carrying HD geometry. Not sure why that's so. Alright, so this is it. So we had HD geometry with our forelimb and our leg, but It is it's sort of less relevant compared to the head. Just quickly color this guy. All right, that's pretty good. Okay. Right, so I wanted to start detailing and tweaking the beak a little bit more, and that's exactly what we're going to do. All right, transparency. Good. working with ZBrush. So the beak is almost finished. Let me import a couple alphas. So just trying to create some flaking levels over the beak. I want to try level. Doesn't seem to work too good. It's a trim dynamic. apologies for the lack of talk for the stream number 14. I had a little bit of struggling with this with you know working on this model, and as well the weather is pretty like dozy. I'm not sure how to describe it. Like, you know, one of those bad Mondays. So my brain is sort of spongy and, you know, slow. Let's add some flaking. So I think that's pretty good. I'll maybe tweak it a little bit more when I start adding color. Let me save. Back in a second. So I'm back. So let me just quickly adjust some of these larger scales on the forelimb, and I'll need to detail our claws. So I'm creating some flakings and a little bit of detailing of these larger scales on the forelimbs. And to all that are wondering why am I using, if you're wondering about that, why am I using Dinocheirus forelimbs? This is what I said initially, since there's a little bit of like time squeeze. I need to. I decided to, you know, recycle Dinocheirus mesh because ultimately it does have similar proportions to Therizinosaurus. So I'm sort of recycling pieces of, you know, Dinocheirus to create Therizinosaurus, and the head and the neck had the most changes. And the arms, like forelimbs and the feet, they needed to be changed the least. And so this is what I'm doing right now. And the major changes being in the proportions. Or all different proportions, and Therizinosaurus being famed for his long, extremely long, disproportionately big forelimb claws. Also, Therizinosaurus has a phalanx, a fourth digit on its feet. Like Dinocheirus, that which, from what I have understood, does not. So there's one other small detail that I can share with you. So basically, when you start applying details, when you start pulling your pen over a surface, if you have the shortcut set up for subdivision and subtracting in additive mode, you can see them here. So you have a Z add and Z sub, and so if you have a shortcut set for these two features, you can literally switch from, you know, Z add and Z sub without ever lifting the pen from the surface, if that's what suits your, like, you know, workflow or whatever you're doing at the time. So basically, this is what I'm doing right now. Like, I'm going to show you example. Like, this is sub, add, sub, add, sub, add, sub, add, sub, add, sub, add. So I'm just pressing my button that switches from, you know, one to from one to the other. And you know, for some elements, for some things that you're working on, this might be, you know, useful, this method. So I'm basically combining this feature with, you know, lifting and, you know, I'm not doing it like 100% completely this way or the other. Basically, you know, you should just, you know, create yourself a workflow. That you feel sort of comfortable with. Then again, you know, you should experiment as well, because experimenting leads to, you know, becoming better and faster or whatever. Hey man, how are you? Good to see you again. Mata, you son of a bitch. What's the matter? See how you got you pushing too many pencils? Yeah, I was just speaking about this before. I guess the case of Mondays, I'm sort of feeling sleepy the entire day, and so I've been keeping my mouth shut and slowly working, and I apologize again for for a silent treatment. It's just you cannot fight your brain when you're sort of sleepy and slow and sort of like a chewing gum. Exactly. Oh man, I'm struggling to do Arnie as well. Exactly. No, it's not like that. No. Well, that's good. You should be productive, dude. Have you ever seen that Arnold Schwarzenegger a motivational speech that he gave? There are like 6 points that he's making. And I think the last point that he made was it sounded something like only 6 hours of sleep a day. 6 hours. If you want to succeed, you need to sleep only 6 hours. Everything else is bullshit. So you need to work, and work, and work harder. Good to hear, man. Although, as I'm saying, I'm feeling pretty, like, sleepy and down and under the weather. I'm hoping the Tuesday is going to be a lot better after 6 hours of sleep. I have eaten a lot of. Oh my god! I have eaten a lot of ice cream. That's why my throat is sore. I'm having difficulty speaking, let alone lifting weights. So the rule number 7, do not eat too much ice cream. No matter what else, no matter what everybody tells you, you shouldn't eat too much ice cream. Sure, man. Take it easy. And Maria, do it. I asked my wife to turn on the light. She's always having difficulties with these switches that we have. How you been? Awesome. I guess nothing beats a feeling of coming home after Monday, work, or coming home, or the last hour of Friday work at work. I guess those feelings can't be beaten in terms of work days. That's great. Digital sculpting at that doesn't get any realer than that, realistic than that.
One man, one desire. He was using ZBrush since the 7th grade. And then his RAM got broken.
I need to work on that joke. I need to figure out, the scenario for. For that imaginative movie.
One man, one desire.
my voice is like gone bad since I ate some ice cream over the weekend. And yeah, that doesn't go well. Hand in hand. So much about consistency. Consistency. Thank you.
that.
What did I do right now? So I'm masking a claw claws. We're masking claws for some detailing. ZBrush mask is a pretty neat feature and pretty underrated, maybe. I'm not sure. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's just me who feels that way. So we've made the mask, and now we need to create details for our claws. So this is going to be done with track rack brush. We need to change the texture. Hold on a sec. Maybe this one. It might do the trick. So we need to blunt the tips of the claw a little bit, because you know, animal as large as Therizinosaurus would certainly not have its claws, you know, sharp as we made them look. Especially if the, you know, theories about digging for food and stuff like foraging, you know, through ground and shell ponds or whatever is true, then. Then, you know, its claws would most certainly wouldn't be sharp. So imagine that these forelimbs were 2.5 meters long, and somewhere they're like, you know, like estimates that it might have reached 3 meters in length, you know, with claws and everything. So that's pretty freaking huge for a forelimb, you know. So, you know, we're not talking, you know, forelimbs that are like, you know, that belong to a quadrupedal animal that is, you know, moving on its four limbs. This is like bipedal theropod that, you know, might have leaned, you know, and used its forelimbs for moving, but probably not in a way, you know, like genuine quadrupedal animals do. And so, considering that, it's pretty amazing, the size. Oh wait, I wanted to use track rack. That's it. Nope. To load some more and some more. So if your alpha palette becomes too crowded, you might want to press reset, and it removes all the alphas from, you know, alpha palette, but it keeps them in here, so you know you do not have to re-import them again and again and again. Okay. These have some type of grooves. I'm not sure if they qualify to what you've seen, or you know, to what might have been, but like there are some grooves here. If you can see, come on. This one isn't seamless. Gosh darn it. Man, I had so many seamless textures and I forgot where I put them. A couple days ago I was cleaning my desk, removing some files and folders to my external desks, and I had to, I probably, you know, removed some of these as well, which wasn't my intention, but so now I'm trying to figure out where, you know, these folders are. Alright, so this one, this is a seamless one. I'll have to make it work. Not good. So let me try and increase this and so we need to tweak our map a little bit. No. Wrong move. Alright, so let's see whether this will work. A little bit too much. I'll need to smooth it out a bit. aliens and alien and aliens from James Cameron, and the alien from Ridley Scott, and the third one, the prison world, not bad, although poor in comparison to the previous two. And then the fourth, I think, with Ron Perlman and his crew, like, it's not bad, but also lacking in comparison to the first two. And Prometheus, I had high expectations for this one, and it sort of didn't meet them. But the music was perfect. I loved, some bits, and visually it was very powerful, this movie, Prometheus, and the score, the music was just phenomenal. I loved it. But, some directing decisions were debatable, or whatever the word is. Yeah, the score in Prometheus was just stunning. And visuals, like, the planet, the spaceships, and some bits visually were stunning as well. Too bad, the plot was relatively lacking, in comparison to those two elements. But it had potential, and, somehow it didn't come through for me. Some people liked it, some hated it. For me, it was sort of, as you described it, like, meh, just could have been so much better. It's like when I'm criticizing these movies, when I'm looking at them critically, it's not like, some people, like, maybe think, like, I could have done a better job, or, who, this guy or that one could have done a better job. I mean, I'm aware that, directing and putting together something as complex as, movie nowadays, with all these elements, that have to work together, is not an easy thing, but I'm not sure, like, there should be some sort of mechanism that for, proof reading, proof watching the thing, like a brain pool of guys that, need to have a consensus in order for the movie to be, or majority needs to, vote it up to be considered finished, or, heading in the right direction or something. And this is something that Hollywood movies are, desperately lack in most of the movies that are, being produced today. They have brilliant special effects. They have, the vistas, the landscapes, everything is, phenomenal. And, when it comes to, and the actors do the best they can, given the screenplay and whatever director wants them to do. And I'm not sure, it's just, as if studio owners and producers, or you know, whoever, are like, you know, like they're more concentrated on, you know, getting the money back and having a good financial turnaround than, you know, creating something great. Like, you know, they should change their priorities maybe or something, not sure. Because essentially, if you create a phenomenal movie, you'll, you know, more than likely, you know, make a profit, so. That's it. This, you know, you nailed it with the comment, like the risk assessment. Like, that's it. This is what's happening, and unfortunately, it's, you know, it isn't good. And it's like they're sticking to these, you know, proven formulas, and you know, so you know, do this, that, and you know. Make your characters do that, this, and you know, whatever, and people will love it, or general public will love it, and you know, we'll make money. I'm keeping high hopes for Star Wars, although, you know, it is yet to be seen, so could go either way. I need to save this, and I'll head out for a little while, and I'll be back in like 2 hours or so, and I'll start a part 3. So it'll be like, you know, 2 more hours. of stream, probably. Depending on traffic conditions. As Arnold Schwarzenegger would have put it. Yeah, okay, so a little bit later. Cheers.